Jesus will make a way. Jesus will make a way through every dark cloud, through every day. I know that Jesus will make a way.
I've been tested and been tried, tossed by winds on every side, face mountains in my way, couldn't see the light of day. In my desperate hour, I just called on His name and found that Jesus, He made a way.
Jesus will make a way.
Tempted to give up and felt so ashamed, but then I looked to Him and I called on His name and found that Jesus, He made a way.
Jesus will make a way. Jesus will make a way. Jesus will make a way through every dark cloud, through every day. I know that Jesus, I know that Jesus, I know that Jesus.
Well, God bless you, and I pray that everything that we prepare for you over the weekend was a blessing to you, to the church. And it has been a wonderful opportunity. I want to thank Pastor Morris, Dr. Morris, for being with us here in Culacua. I want to say to the church, thank you for your commitment. Thank you for participating during the whole weekend. And thank you for being with me tonight as I open the Word of God and share my thoughts, my heart with you as we close this beautiful Sabbath. And we start a new week. We want to ask the Lord to guide us through the message this afternoon. Dear Father, we ask you, Lord, to give us your presence, to give us your mind and your heart. We ask you, Lord, that you be the one that communicates the message to your people. Thank you, Father, because we know that through the Holy Spirit, You're going to speak to your church in Florida and everywhere. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the Southern Union and Florida Conference, of course, we decided last year that 2021 was going to be the year of reconnecting. That was the word, reconnect. Reconnecting with God. Reconnecting with Jesus. Reconnecting with the mission. And reconnecting with the church. And as we try to reset the button, and we look to the future with cautious optimism, I believe that we do well if we reflect on the things that we have gone through over the last plus months. I remember very well, it was March 16. I will never forget that day, that Sabbath, the day that we call our pastors, we called our churches and leaders and said, we recommend that you close the church. And at the beginning I thought, and I share with the administration and many pastors in the field, that we will be closed for a couple of weeks, maybe three or four. And then we realized that that was not going to be the case. It has been more than a year since that March 16 that we had to close our churches, and we're still trying to reopen. We're still trying to go back to some kind of normality or normalcy that it is very hard to define. I believe that we must conclude that it has been very painful. It has been hard. And it has been a very humbling and sovereign experience. We have gone through a pandemic. We're still going through a pandemic, worldwide pandemic, the likes of which we had not seen in the last 100 years. I believe it would be healthy to recognize how we have felt during this time. And the words that best describe those feelings, I would say that are vulnerable, sad, afraid. We have felt like our present reality is not going to end. And I'm saying all these things because it is vital that we acknowledge how we feel in order to heal, in order to overcome. We need to be able to express, to recognize our reality. So an essential part of healing and overcoming is having awareness of what we are going through. Think about the last 12 months, maybe more. Think about all the things that we have gone through. Not only the pandemic, think about social unrest. Think about political unrest. Think about the things that we have endured over the last 12 months. Sadly, as one trial is concluding, at least two other very tragic situations just happened this week. The images you see from those videos are extremely disturbing. It feels like we cannot escape a bad dream where violence has become part of our culture, our society. Mass shootings are happening almost every week. And as Christians, we will continue to call for what is right, to do good, to seek justice, correct oppression, bring justice to the weak, and support the causes of the wounded. And I'm quoting the Bible, Isaiah 1:17. This is the call. This is what we as Christians must do. As I mentioned, we have lived through political unrest with no precedent in our country's history. In the last year, we have seen natural disasters one after another. Look at what is happening in St. Vincent right now. Fires, droughts, floods, hurricanes. We have gone through unemployment, economic hardship. We have lost family members, loved ones, church members, people that used to sit next to us in the pews in the church. We have lost loved ones, dear ones. We have endured isolation with psychological and emotional implication. There has been so much uncertainty. Yes, that is our reality. Now, there's a bigger picture. There's a bigger reality that I want you to see this afternoon. Because God wants us to be part of that movement, that beautiful plan of salvation and redemption and reconciliation that He designed for lost men since the beginning of the world. Even though we have gone through all of this, the church has continued to fulfill its mission. We have learned to adapt, yes. We have learned to endure. We have learned the real meaning of being faithful to God when things don't look good, when things don't feel good, and we know that they don't feel good because they're not. When we consider the bigger picture, if we allow the light of God to illuminate our present reality based on the truth and the prophecies foretold by Jesus Himself, we have to praise our Lord and Savior because He revealed to us that God will never abandon us, never forsake us. Jesus taught us in His life, with His life, in the days of His flesh, the Bible says, in the days of His flesh, He revealed to us, He taught us that life will always win over death. And if you lost a dear one, I have a message for you. Resurrection will win over the grave. That love will always win over hatred. That freedom will always win over oppression. Jesus taught us that. That forgiveness, as Christians, we must learn to forgive. That forgiveness will always win over destruction and condemnation. That salvation and restoration will always win over destruction. That reconnecting with one another will always win over isolation and separation. And I want to say that again. Reconnecting with one another will always win over isolation and separation. And this is more for the church today. I want to tell you that the pews will not remain empty forever. So as the Apostle Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, therefore, he said, encourage one another with these words. God designed us, created us to live, to love. This is an eternal truth. This is something that you can write in stone. This is something that you can proclaim to the world. When you look at the bigger picture, you're going to see that God created us to live, to love, to be free, to forgive, to save, to restore, to be the body of Christ. Yes, we're going through a worldwide pandemic. I know that things don't look good and they don't feel good. But God has a plan. And in that plan, the eternal truth, the bigger picture, is telling us that God created you. God created us to live, to love, to be free, to forgive, to save, to restore, to be the body of Christ. And the body of Christ is meant to be united, supporting one another, complementing each other, fulfilling the mission for which we became people, the people of God, even in the face of adversity. Look around. Where are you going to place your hope? Think about that just for a few seconds. Where are you going to place your hope? Look around. Look at the world that is falling apart. Look around. Where are you going to place your hope? Is there a human organization in this world that you can hope and wait for the best? I have lived long enough to realize that the only hope in the world today, as we fast approach the second coming of Jesus, is the church. It is Christ's church. The church. Well, Pastor, you know the church is not perfect. Yes, I know. But it is the only entity organized by Jesus himself that brings life, love, salvation, forgiveness, reconciliation. It is the only hope of our world today. In addition, as we study the Bible and we reveal the prophecies that describe the condition of the world previous to the second coming of Jesus, we know that things are not going to get better at the end of times. We know that. So yes, the church, Christ's church, True believers are the only hope of our world today. Ellen G. White wrote, "The church is God's appointed agency for the salvation of men. It was organized for service, and its mission is to carry the gospel to the world. From the beginning, it has been God's plan that through the church shall be reflected to the world the fullness of God and his sufficiency. The members of the church, those whom he has called out of darkness into his marvelous light, are to show forth his glory. The church is the source of the riches of the grace of Christ, and through the church will eventually be made manifest, even to the principalities and powers in heavenly places, the final and full display of the love and the grace of God." So yes, the church. And I'm saying all of this because I need to call you to reconnect with the church of God. It is sad to learn that people are running away from the church, from spiritual things. People are looking for solutions and answers in the wrong places. The concern of Christianity today is that Christians are not necessarily planning to come back to church. We believe that the church of God, the Advent Church, was given a message to be proclaimed to the world. And we believe that the message is the most beautiful message that someone can preach and someone can proclaim to the world, and that is that Jesus is coming again, and that we believe that Jesus is coming soon. So quoting the Bible, do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, what did I say, saints? Just what? In a little while. Just in a little while. He who is coming will come, and he will not delay. And but the righteous one will live by faith. And I take no pleasure, God said, I take no pleasure of the one who shrinks back. But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. Yes, during the last year, we have gone through a lot. But I want to share with you that I have also been comforted, supported, and affirmed by your prayers, by your letters, by your messages, by your love. And I want to say thank you. Thank you. I want to share with you just a few messages that I've gotten during this last year for you to see how wonderful, how beautiful is our Jesus. Someone wrote to me after their mother passed away. I went to the funeral to minister to this family. Thank you for being there for us in our time of need and for your encouraging words. It is greatly appreciated. Thank you. Pray for us. Another person wrote to me, beautiful testimonies. I write a few lines to share that in my 60 years of life, when I look back and I look to the future, I can only see the wonders of God. The miracles that God has performed with his people. And then she wrote, as for me and my household, this is a single mother, someone that is struggling, someone that lost a job, I will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. And then she wrote, continue to pray for us. So many testimonies. I'm just sharing a few. Pastor Allan, we are requesting your prayers. We have lost everything. Loved ones, job, and the house. Hopeless does not even describe how we feel. We're not working with a bank in order to keep our house. Please pray for God to give us the answers. One more, maybe two. Again, I have so many. Pastor Allan and Elsa, pain and sadness have come to our shores. With the loss of our dear father due to COVID, we recognize that our only hope is in Jesus. At this time, we cling to the promises of God. Thank you for your love and presence during agonizing times. Keep praying for us. We need you very much. We remain faithful. And I have one more. This one is It's amazing because this is the testimony. It's a long letter. I'm not going to be able to read it, but it's a testimony of a brother in Christ that made a promise to the Lord when he thought he was going to lose his job. Pastor Allan, at the beginning of the pandemic, I was very concerned with keeping my job. Many co-workers were being let go, and I thought I was going to lose my income. It would have been a disaster for my family. I pleaded with the Lord and committed to be faithful to him. I promised to tithe. Listen, I promised to tithe faithfully and support the church as I never did before. In the middle of a pandemic, Conrad, this is a beautiful testimony. Pastor, today I write to you to testify that God is faithful. I have my job and I have received more, so much more in the middle of a pandemic. So much more that I can only say that God is real and is faithful to his children. Faithful to God. God will always be faithful to you. So I want to take this opportunity as I read these testimonies to you to thank you. I want to thank you because it is the appropriate time for me to do it. I want to thank everyone, faithful brothers and sisters. You chose to be faithful in the face of uncertainty and adversity. You chose to support the church, and you have faithfully supported the church, and you have faithfully offered your time, your contributions to keep the mission moving forward. Thank you, thank you, thank you. 65 plus thousand members in our association. I want to say thank you to every pastor for your dedication and ministry. You have been there even in the face of risking your own health to serve the flock that God has assigned to you. I want to say thank you to every teacher because you have given everything under the most difficult circumstances. You have been there. You have fulfilled your call. You have put the Christian education of our children first. Thank you. Thank you. I want to thank you, leaders of the church. I want to thank the executive committee for your support. I want to thank the union leaders, the division leaders. Thank you for your support. I want to thank Advent Health. Thank you for your constant support. Thank you for helping and serving the community in the places where you are located and supporting our communities of faith. To the doctors and nurses and first responders, thank you in capital letters. Thank you. Thank you. We want to thank our chaplains for fulfilling their call. As shepherds, they are at the forefront of the crisis, ministering to broken people. And finally, from the bottom of my heart, and on behalf of more than 65,000 believers in our conference, I want to say thank you to our community service and disaster relief team for their constant support and presence in the field serving the church. Dr. Conrad, thank you. Thank you. Someone told me the other day, Allan, I am concerned. I'm so concerned. I feel hopeless. What are you thinking about? I asked. Why do you feel like that? My future, he said. My future. And I replied, what makes you look so hopeless? What makes it look so hopeless? He answered to what he said, my past. I'm concerned about the future because of my past. As I tried to minister to this dear brother in Christ, I told him, you know what? I'm also concerned. But I'm not hopeless. I am hopeful. Yes. Why? He asked. And I answer, because of my past. Because of my past, I have hope for the future. My past gives me the assurance that God remains in control. So, dear brother and sister, in reviewing our past history, having traveled over every step of our present standing, of our present reality, I can say, praise God. I'm quoting Ellen G. White. As I see what God has done, I am filled with astonishment and with confidence in Christ as our leader. We have nothing to fear for the future except as we shall forget our past. As we shall forget the way the Lord has led us and his teaching in our history. I'm concerned, but I'm not hopeless. I know what the church is going through and is going to go through in the future. I know that as we approach the second coming of Jesus, things are not going to get better. And you know it. You know it because you feel it and you see it and you're experiencing that this world is falling apart. So today, I want to say to you, let us reconnect. Instead of going away, instead of separating, instead of not connecting or staying at home or going to other places, how about if we commit to the Lord? How about if we say, Lord, I want to commit to you. I want to reconnect with the mission, with the church. I want Jesus to be real in my heart. You see, I do believe that God is still holding the winds, but the winds are blowing already. I do believe that things are going to come, difficult things. And they're going to come fast, the Bible says. For the love of his children, God is going to rush. The signs of his judgment and destruction. The winds are blowing, and I want to say to you, it is the church, the only place where you are going to find that secure place with other believers, the body of Christ, those that believe that Jesus is eternal life, that Jesus is resurrection, that in Jesus we find forgiveness and transformation, that in Jesus we're reconciled with God, that Jesus is the only truth and the way and life. He is the only formula for a human heart to reconnect with the Father, to go back to God. So as I call you today, as I read the testimonies, as I create awareness of the realities of the world that we're living into, I want to read this last message from the Bible, 1 Peter chapter 5. This is the message that I believe the church needs today. Humble yourselves. These are not times for you to be proud. I'm telling you. These are not times for you to believe that you have all the answers. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that He may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on Him, because He cares for you. Amen. Pastor, I decided to be faithful to God. Pastor, our only hope is the second coming of Jesus and the resurrection. Pastor, thank you because you were there in the time, in our time of need. As we come together as the body of Christ, as we reconnect, we need to humble ourselves. We need to cast all of our anxiety on Him, because we know the past has taught us that God cares for you, for us. Be alert and be sober of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to destroy. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of suffering. And the God of all grace, who calls you to His eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while. A what? A little while. That phrase again. A little while. After you have suffered a little while, will Himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To Him be the power forever and ever again. Amen. For yours, Jesus, is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. So my appeal to you today, reconnect. Find the way to reconnect with God. God has never disconnected from you. It is us that in our rebellious attitude that we cannot explain, we decide to walk away from God. But God is there. He's waiting for you. He's waiting for you to say it. Just a simple prayer. Father, I'm here. I need you. Call upon God and He will rescue you. Jesus loves you. He will be there for you. Let us reconnect to the church, the body of Christ, the association of believers. Yes, I know the church is not perfect, but I can tell you it is the only entity in this world today where you can find a wonderful message of salvation and reconciliation with God, where you can find good people. People that are trying to please God, to live for God, and reconnect to the mission that made us people, the people of God, and Jesus will always be there for you. To Him be the power forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
didn't see coming, and no one will blame you though. If you cried in private, if you try to hide it away, so no one knows, no one will see if you stop believing. Oh my soul, you are not alone. There's a place where fear has to face a God you know. Promise that someday it all works out, 'cause this is the valley, and even now he is breathing on your dry bones. And there will be dancing, there will be where beauty was ash and stone. This much I know. Oh, my soul, you are not alone. There's a place where fear has to face the God you know. One more day, he will make a way. Let him show you how you can lay this down.
Yes, you're not alone. Be encouraged. Encourage one another with his words. Life will always win. The moment you reconnect with God, your eyes are open and you see the bigger picture. You're looking at things that are happening in this world today, and you're discouraged, you're sad. But the moment you reconnect with God, a bigger picture opens in front of your eyes, and you can see. You can see because the life of Jesus revealed this truth to us. Life will win. And if you lost a dear one, as I did, I tell you, resurrection will win over the grave. Freedom will win. Salvation will win. Reconciliation with the Father, with God, will win. That's the truth. And the pews will not remain empty forever. The gospel will be preached to the world. And God is going to save His children and His church. And Jesus is going to come. And the kingdom of God will be established forever. Because God always wins. May the Lord bless you today. If you are disconnected, if you feel alone, if you're lost, you don't know what to do, if you're confused, if you're afraid of your future because of your past, I'm telling you today, don't be afraid of your future. Look at your past. Look at the things of the Lord. Look at the things that God has done in your past. He will carry you on. He's your answer. Jesus is your answer. Reconnect. Reconnect with God, with the church, with the mission, because that will always win. Dear Father, we humble ourselves before you today. These are not times to be proud. These are not times to waste time arguing about things, peripheral stuff. We have dedicated a long time to discuss those things. We believe, because you prophesied, and this church, the Adventist Church, understands the seasons and the times. We believe that Jesus is coming soon. That the second coming is near, nearer every day. So we humble ourselves and we surrender to you, Lord. And we want to say, we want to reconnect, Father. Forgive us. Forgive me. Give me salvation. Give me reconciliation. And give me the assurance that in Jesus we're saved. Father, bless your church. Thank you because you have been with us over all this time, this year that has been tough. But thank you, Father, because we are here. We're moving forward. The mission is moving forward. And we know, Lord, that very soon Jesus is going to appear in the clouds of heaven. And we will be with our Savior forever and ever. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Pastor Machado, thank you. Thank you so much for an invitation like that. How amazing, how absolutely amazing it would be if this reconnect vision would be a starting point for an Elijah message in Florida Conference in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Imagine the hearts of fathers turned to their children. Imagine the hearts of children turning to their fathers and their mothers and a reconnect happening like we have never, ever seen. How beautiful that would be. I'm going to start praying for that.
Amen. And as we have been blessed by the messages this weekend on Reconnect, I want to leave with our membership, our viewers, John 15, 4 and 5, where it reminds us to stay connected to the vine, to stay connected to Jesus Christ, for truly without him, we can do nothing.
And with those beautiful words, we finish our CAN meeting this year. One lasting Pastor Morris, thank you for being with us. It's been amazing. We really appreciate your presence, your love for Jesus. Thank you. And to everyone that is watching, we love you. Thank you for your support. We're here for you. Let us reconnect. Let us come together and be the body of Christ, because Jesus is coming soon. And God bless you. Have a wonderful week. And may the Lord bless the rest of this year, 2021. God bless you. We love you.
Good night.
Bye-bye now.